The Philippine Budget Department says the national budget for 2024 is estimated at around 5.8 trillion pesos. That's about 9.5% higher than the 5.3 trillion peso budget for this year. But Budget Secretary Amena Pangandaman says that increase is relatively low compared to other years.
It increased by 2,820 billion, but it's still lower if you compare it from pre-pandemic levels. Of course, you know, education it will always be on top priority for our constitution. Infrastructure, it has been a neglect in terms of investment for the last 20 years. Agriculture, definitely, it will still be a priority. If you will notice, po, I think it's a right thing to invest in agriculture because our GDP growth, yung share po ng agriculture sector, before po, it was 0.1%, parang 0%. Ngayon po, with more investments in agriculture, so nag-increase po productivity and yield ng ating mga farmers, yung share po niya sa ating GDP, positive na.
The DBM will present its version of the 2024 budget to the Cabinet Thursday. Pangandaman says they plan to submit it to Congress a week after the President's State of the Nation address in July. The controversial Maharlika Investment Fund Bill takes a step closer into becoming a law. That's after Senate President Juan Miguel Zubiri signed the bill in Washington, D.C., along with other measures, including the Estate Tax Amnesty Extension Act and a measure recognizing Baler in Aurora as the birthplace of Philippine surfing. The MIF bill will now be transmitted to Malacanang for President Ferdinand Marcos Jr.'s signature. The sovereign wealth funds of other countries use excess earnings. But in the case of the Philippines, the MIF will source its 500 billion peso seed money from government funds. Critics have warned the purpose of the fund remains unclear and the timing way off. Over now to Washington's request for Manila to temporarily house Afghans. The chairperson of the Senate Committee on Foreign Relations asserts there is a need to carefully study the proposal. Senator Amy Marcos says there are other issues that need urgent attention from the Philippine government. She also slams the U.S. for its delayed response on the situation in Afghanistan.
Ito, nakakapagtaka kasi empleyado ng Amerikano to, hindi naman inaapi daw. Kaso nga lang, gustong umalis pagkat sila yung mga interpreter operative. Sabi ng iba, spia. Nako, nakakatakot yan. Intelligence officer, translator, yung mga ganon, driver. Kaya medyo nakakatakot dahil aasa lang tayo sa Amerikano dahil wala naman tayong kakayahan na investigahan kung sino-sino mga to. Samantalang sila, kilala naman nila, tauhan nila, eh malay naman natin kung sino yung mga yan. Kaya ang akin, bago tayo maawa sa iba, maawa muna tayo kaya sa sarili natin. Nakakanerbiyos.
As for the vice chairperson of the Senate Panel on Foreign Relations, allowing refugees from Afghanistan to temporarily stay in the Philippines is the highest form of compliance to human rights. Senator Francis Tolentino also appeals to Filipinos to avoid stereotyping Afghans.
I don't see any reason to hype the hysteria all over again. Is it legal to help a fellow human being in need? Is it illegal to provide a temporary shelter for someone in need? I don't see anything wrong. States of conscience, morality, and principles of international law would justify all of this. Meron na hype kasi lalong-lalo na pag nabinrand yung mga Afghans na terrorists. Mm-mm. Kaya nga sabi ko, hindi naman terrorist lahat po ng ating mga kapatid na Muslim.
Manila's envoy to Washington, meanwhile, sees no effect on the relations between the U.S. and the Philippines should the government ultimately decide not to accept Afghan refugees. Ambassador Jose Manuel Romales says ties between the allies go beyond this specific request. But he insists the move of the U.S. is purely for humanitarian purposes. Romualdez adds they expect a decision on the matter by next month.
I would think that before the middle of July, we should be able to make a decision. And I think the memorandum for the president's approval or disapproval, whichever the case may be, will be sent to Malacanang as probably as late as July 15. There are many, many more things that we need to work with the United States. Some of them we've already said we cannot do it for some reason or the other. We have been requested on many occasions by the United States to support a resolution at the United Nations. On many occasions, we also did not. So, and it did not affect our relationship with the United States. There's a mutual respect, in my view, between the U.S. and the Philippines.
The Philippine Foreign Affairs Department turning over some of its functions to the Migrant Workers Department. The DFA said the assistance to nationals functions for overseas Filipino workers will now be under the DMW. Starting July 1st, all legal and medical assistance cases, as well as repatriation and shipment of remains, will be handled by the DMW. Migrant Workers Secretary Susan Ople earlier said her agency is ready to take over the assistance program. The DFA will continue to handle cases of Filipino tourists, students, dual citizens, and permanent residents in other countries. The DFA, meanwhile, welcomes the U.S. State Department's recent trafficking in persons report, which gave the Philippines the so-called Tier 1 status. Tier 1, a ranking that the Philippines has maintained in the last 8 years, is the highest in the three-tier ranking. It means the country fully meets the minimum standards for the elimination of trafficking. The DFA says this is an acknowledgement of the Philippines' whole-of-government approach in fighting and preventing such crime. The Philippine government reaffirming its commitment to fight human trafficking. A Justice Department official admits many Filipinos are still lured to exploitation due to poverty. Undersecretary Nicolas Felix T. says it's time to enjoin more sectors of society to join efforts against all forms of trafficking.
One thing that we intend to do is the need to engage the private sector more. We are very thankful for RA 11930, which set forth a lot of obligations for private entities, not just financial intermediaries, but also telcos, internet platforms, hotels, as well as internet kiosks. And this fight against human trafficking, it's whole of nation, not just whole of government. It means that everyone, even the private sector, even NGOs, should be involved. And I think it's really high time for us to push the private sector to be more involved in the fight against human trafficking.
The Philippine Senate's Tourism Committee begins its probe on complaints filed against budget carrier Cebu Pacific and other airlines. The inquiry comes after a slew of travelers accused Cebu Pacific of overbooking flights and offloading passengers. During the hearing, the Senate panel's chairperson, Senator Nancy Binay, urged all local airline companies to step up their services to protect the image of the country's tourism sector.
Baka yung inaasahan nating repeat tourist, baka di na bumalik at markahan ng bad review ang Pilipinas dahil sa di magandang experience nila. Ang goal natin sa hearing na ito is to find out bakit ganito palagi ang sitwasyon. We need to identify the problems and we need to craft doable and strategic solutions and implement them as soon as possible. Hindi pwedeng pasahero na lang lagi ang patuloy na mag-a-adjust.
For Senator Risa Ontiveros, it is not just the airline companies that need to be held accountable.
Hindi lang airlines ang dapat managot. The regulators, Civil Aeronautics Board, and the Department of Transportation, the agencies mandated to supervise, control, and regulate these air carriers. Hindi rin ako papayag na isama sa kultura natin ang canceled, rescheduled, at delayed flights.
Aside from Cebu Pacific, similar complaints were lodged against Philippine Airlines and AirAsia. Over now to Albay, where an evacuee from Daragat tests positive for COVID-19. Albay's provincial province says the patient is a 12-year-old boy who was in contact with another evacuee who tested positive last week. He is asymptomatic and isolating in a town facility. His close contacts were released from isolation after they tested negative for COVID. Meanwhile, the Albay Emergency Management Office is set to assist the decampment of around 5,000 evacuees from Santo Domingo, Albay. Governor Edsel Greco Lagman earlier questioned orders to evacuate families outside Mayon's 6-kilometer permanent danger zone.
Nakikiusap din po kami na kung maaari ay mabigyan po ng tamang explanation yung mga tao, ma-orient sila dahil hindi naman po natin walang bahala yung kanilang takot. Ang role po natin ngayon dito, yung LGUs, ay ipaliwanag po sa mga tao yung dapat na pangambahan at kung bakit kinakailangan po nila bumalik sa kanilang mga tirahan.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. leads the rollout of bivalent COVID vaccines to healthcare workers and senior citizens. In his speech, Marcos expressed his gratitude towards the government of Lithuania, which donated some 390,000 doses of the bivalent vaccines earlier this month.
The Philippines conveys its gratitude to the governments of the Republic of Lithuania for the generosity and their donation of the country's first batch of bivalent vaccines. I am hopeful that we will further deepen our cooperation in such areas, both our great nations, as well as sustain this bond of friendship that we have strengthened now. Rest assured that this government, under this administration, treasures that special relationship, and your act of generosity today will certainly not go unnoticed or ever be forgotten.
The Health Department urged eligible Filipinos to get inoculated with the bivalent vaccines, which are modified to target both the original and Omicron strains of COVID.
The heart of our national COVID-19 vaccination program is the protection first of our defenders against COVID-19 and also the most vulnerable. We are always grateful for and inspired by the strong support that no less than our Honorable President has for vaccination that saves lives. Nasa Healthy Pilipinas, ang bawat buhay ay mahalaga. We have been working together. We are now feeling the results. An open economy, a once more vibrant community. The Department of Health urges everyone, starting with our healthcare workers and senior citizens, to strengthen the immunity against COVID-19 by getting these bivalent boosters.